Have you ever wondered just how powerful your mind is? The placebo and nocebo effects have had scientists asking this question for years, and a wide range of theories and case studies exist to supplement evidence in this field. Today, we're going to be taking you through a case study to help you better understand what exactly these responses are and why we should pay attention to them. Before we dive into the case study, let's become more familiar with what exactly these terms mean. The NIH defines the placebo effect as a beneficial health outcome resulting from a person's anticipation that an intervention will help. What this means is that it is the person's expectation of the intervention working that creates a beneficial effect rather than the intervention itself. In contrast, Planas et al. Defined the nocebo effect as the induction or the worsening of symptoms induced by sham or active therapies. In this case, we are saying that a person's expectation of a negative outcome resulting from an intervention is what creates that outcome rather than the intervention itself. Let's move on to our case study. Meet Sam. Sam was recently enrolled as a human participant in a randomized controlled trial looking at a potential treatment for wobbly legs, and is placed in a group receiving a sugar pill as a placebo drug while the other group receives the real or the active drug. He doesn't know that he's receiving a placebo, and both groups are told there's a slight risk of getting a very dry mouth as a side effect of the active drug. While Sam is not getting the active drug, his legs become much less wobbly, and he ends up experiencing a dry mouth. Knowing that he's only receiving a sugar pill, why would these effects still be seen?
There are two key psychological theories that scientists have debated over as to why the placebo and nocebo effects occur. Expectancy theory describes that having a positive expectation of a certain outcome through direct or explicit instruction leads to the body inducing its own responses to fulfill that expectation. It's important to note that expectancy theory is forward-looking, meaning that it is focused on how we respond to the potential for certain events to occur in the future. In contrast, classical conditioning is more of a backward-looking theory, because it describes how the body uses certain neutral cues that have been associated with a particular effect in the past to enact the same effect when these cues are present, not in the active intervention. For example, if someone were to take a medication with a very distinctive appearance and taste, and if that medication was eventually replaced by a sugar pill with the same appearance and the same taste, the body might still associate the sugar pill with the response elicited by the original medication and elicit some response along these lines. In both theories, it is important to note that the psychological responses that end up getting evoked are done so from within the body rather than due to an active intervention. According to Wager and Atlas in 2015, the placebo and nocebo effects can be broken down into external and internal contexts. The external context refers to factors outside the body that can be used to cue a placebo or nocebo response, while the internal context refers to what these cues mean to the individual and what the probable psychological and neurological outcomes may be. The main categories of external cues include verbal suggestions, place cues, social cues, and treatment cues. These can result in changes to the internal context, such as helping to reduce stress and other emotions, resulting in the individual feeling cared for, as well as eliciting memories and other associations.
There are some limitations to be aware of with respect to conducting research regarding the placebo and nocebo effects, which is largely due to concerns regarding informed consent in a research context. Shaw and colleagues define informed consent as the process in which a healthcare provider educates a patient about the risks, benefits, and alternatives of a given procedure or intervention. However, the placebo and nocebo responses are only elicited when an individual believes they can expect a certain outcome that may not be associated with the intervention being given. Figuring out how to inform them of the realistic outcomes of the intervention becomes much trickier. Furthermore, failing to sufficiently inform individuals of the probable outcomes of getting involved in the study can even lead to them becoming even more distressed, thereby confounding the ultimate goal of evaluating a placebo or nocebo response from a sole intervention. To combat this, some studies suggest that informing individuals of the possible positive and negative side effects that can still result from placebos can help to resolve some of these misconceptions. However, there is still widespread debate surrounding the next steps to address these limitations. One of the most common myths related to the placebo and nocebo effects that still, in part, persist to date is that these responses are not real. This claim is not true, and there is a plethora of research evidence supporting the neurobiological basis of the placebo and nocebo effects. Numerous neuroimaging studies have demonstrated notable changes at various sites across the brain when placebo or nocebo responses are elicited, as well as changes in physical symptoms that get elicited from individual to individual, such as heart rate variability, as well as changes in the secretion of endorphins and other neurotransmitters and hormones.
While this topic has been of some interest to the scientific community in recent years, there are many other areas that we need to spend more time learning about in order to better understand how exactly these phenomena work. These can include, what are the exact biological processes involved, how do the placebo and nocebo differ from non-specific changes in state following an intervention, and how can the findings help improve the quality of life and safety of individuals in the future receiving psychiatric and medical treatments. In conclusion, we can apply what we've learned to Sam's case. We can see that getting reduced wobbly legs even after taking a sugar pill can be attributed to the placebo effect, while getting a dry mouth would be indicative of a nocebo response as an adverse side effect. Why might this have occurred? Some key theories include expectancy and classical conditioning regarding why Sam is experiencing this now. Some ways in which researchers can induce these effects for future reference include verbal, place, social, and treatment cues. Overall, we hope that this video was able to help you gain a better appreciation of just how powerful your mind is in the context of the placebo and nocebo effects. If you want to learn more about these subjects, make sure to check out the links in the description. Thanks for watching!